Welcome to the SCP Foundation Integrated File Server. To begin, please insert your Foundation personnel badge into the card reader. Authorization. Approved. Please select item's numerical code to view. Processing. Your file is ready to view. Straight Until Morning Hub. The Watchtower. By Dr. Chi Marian. Part 2. Of 2. 54,423 kilometers from Fork, -05. High Earth Orbit. July 13, 1973, 0055 GMT. It is unclear how GRUP vessels target or launch these weapons. Their irregular design does not seem to impact their ballistic effectiveness. V, -13 opened his eyes for the first time. V, -20 had just exploded. There was an invisible wall in front of them, but he knew the solution. They'd go around it. He could feel the ships around him. 18 of his brothers and 4 of the others. The others would be the problem. V, -13 chanted to himself, bringing the comm he needed to redirect his cage. The spirit energies behind him ignited and he directed him on a new path. A small cloud of metal tore towards him, but he evaded it with contemptuous ease. It would take longer to kill these thieves, but they would kilometers from Fork, -05. High Earth Orbit. July 13, 1973, 1:15 hours GMT. I've got multiple encounters, Captain Olnare, for the first time since Leonard had met him, sounded worried. Gunners having trouble getting enough metal in the air. I'm starting to think these guys are a little smarter than a guided missile, sir. Leonard grunted as he tracked the firing solution on the nearest target. The toxin coiled and sprang to life, firing a spread of tungsten at his target. He was rewarded with a small flash of light. Wesker had managed to kill 3 clusters, but his weapon systems had overloaded during the last engagement, leaving his ship dead in space. Jackson's tally was 7 clusters and rising. Lenore was still struggling to shape the 5 clusters that had decided that he was their target, and not the other way around. None of them were fragmented yet. Leonard's tally was 4. That left 1 cluster unaccounted for. Small warning lights had started to flicker on the master console each time he altered course. Queen. He said, punching his comm. Yes, sir. Jackson's voice answered in his ear. Go help Jack. The minute those things decide to break off, we're screwed. What about the last target? I'll handle it. Leonard's telemetry indicated the last target was headed straight for the base. Bring us around. Throttle to full. 34,502 kilometers from Fork, -05. High Earth Orbit. July 13, 1973, 1:15 hours GMT. V, -13 was alone now. His fellows were all lost or stupidly pursuing the wrong targets. He was the only one who knew the true enemy. The Foundation and their evil would be eradicated. His pursuer was gaining on him though. How was that possible? He tried to increase his velocity, but he felt drained. The energy. His energy. It was gone. He closed his eyes again and flew apart in a rage. Suddenly a single kinetic impactor became 100 probar-sized missiles in an ever-widening constellation. 6 light seconds from Fork, -05. Interplanetary space. July 13, 1973, 1:25 hours GMT. Vladimir Vernetsky looked over the weapons officer's shoulder. He felt the energy that fueled these copies waning. This copy of him didn't seem to care about anything anymore but the range indicator, which showed, to Vladimir, an uncomfortably small number. He passed his hand through the spirit's abdomen, and grabbed at something invisible. The hat man disappeared. Vernetsky stepped forward and pressed several buttons. The gamma ray emitter targeting system found Purchase, the ship next to them. He fired, and a slight buzz reverberated throughout the ship. Now there was just one ship left. Vernetsky closed his eyes and raised his hands to the ceiling, while slowly, the spirits around him simply disappeared. Vinetsky smiled as his own energy was restored. The imperfect copies no longer drain on his own power. He reached out with the ship's spirit engines, decelerating it with layer upon layer of sonic force. 9,564 kilometers from Fork, minus 5. Medium Earth orbit. July 13, 1973, 1:25 hours GMT. Colonel. I'm preparing to intercept. Jack's taken some heavy damage. Three of the clusters are down. I can't get him on cams, but he seems to be active. Roger that. Fuck, Queen screamed into the cams. Colonel. I got the last one. But the Jack of Hearts has ceased contact. The reactor, understood. You're too far out to assist here. Give King a tow, and get back to base as soon as you can. Luna and Leonard had come up in training together, but they all knew what they were getting into when they'd launched this morning. Leonard could mourn later. Right now he needed, desperately, to get ahead of this cloud. The red warning lights on his console intensified. Foundation Orbital Research Compound 5, Director Cooper's office. July 19, 1973, 9:22 hours GMT. Telemetry from Colonel Leonard's DCVP indicated that his engines were on the verge of failure. Cooper did his best to avert his eyes from a 5 to 10 silhouette. I have the telemetry in front of me. I was asking for your conclusions on the appropriateness of his actions. Ah. There were approximately 100 impactors, his actions eliminated 42, and the point defense managed to reduce the remainder to 4. What happened next? 05 to 10 electrolarynx made it impossible to determine the emotion behind these questions, but this had all the hallmarks of an interrogation. Two of the impactors missed the station. Two did not. One hit in the residential section, and one struck the D-class wing. Cooper couldn't see 05 to 10 very clearly, but he was sure the man was shifting his position before asking his next question. Casualties. A couple D-class, and Dr. Marco's well. He appears to have ignored the evacuation order. Which D-class? Cooper stopped and searched the information sheet in front of him. D, minus 1,153 and D, minus 2,045. 05 to 10 stopped for a moment before continuing. What do you think would have happened if all 100 of the impactors had made it through? Point defense was surprisingly accurate. Probably 4 more impactors would have struck the station. Given that the strike on the residential section was nearly catastrophic on its own, I'd say the colonel made the right call. Alright. I want the full report before the end of the week. The computer screen went black, and Director Cooper breathed freely for the first time in several minutes. He took a few moments to collect himself, then pressed a button on his desk. Send us Jackson in. Yes, sir, came the reply from the intercom. Captain Jackson opened the door, walked in and took a seat. Miss Jackson, I'd like to start by Captain Jackson, she interjected. I'm sorry. It's Captain. Not Miss. Oh. Cooper felt his face go slightly red with embarrassment. I apologize. Captain Jackson. Cooper tried to get back on track. I'm sorry about your friends. Luna and Leonard were good men. The Ace and Jack crews knew what they were getting into. They saved lives. There's no greater tribute than to keep living in their honor. Still, Leonard sacrificed himself by cutting in front of that last swarm. And you accounted for half of the down clusters. I just happened to be in the right places at the right times. I've been empowered to grant field promotions. Cooper pulled a sheet of paper from one of the stacks in front of him. Since you're probably the best pilots we have right now, this seems to make sense. Jackson took the sheet of paper and glanced over it. You want me to take on Leonard's old command? We do, yes. I can do that. Cooper stood up. I have another meeting in an hour I have to get ready for, but later today that command staff will be having a meeting. 1,300 hours. I'll be there, sir. Jackson stood and saluted Cooper crisply. Cooper was caught flat-footed by that, and tried to do his best to return it properly. The two stood there for a couple of seconds looking at each other before Jackson left. Cooper didn't quite keep it together either. "We have to work on that salute, sir," Jackson said, turning to the door. "Yes, we do," Cooper said.